you had an incredible experience and turnout, and so what we're going to begin with now, the bulk of our time together today is not really the presentation of data, because we didn't do a survey, we did prayer groups, but this was really part of the discernment process, and so we really want to focus in on stories. But a couple of weeks ago, I mentioned this last week in service, and for those of you who are prayer group leaders, that you know that you took a summary sheet and you sent it to Trula, Dwayne, who served as our prayer group coordinator. And those reports were gathered together, and Trula, myself, and our ministers and our worship planning team, we went through those to identify some themes that emerged from our prayer groups. And it was an amazing process. I was surprised by how easily these themes emerged. And so I'll invite now Ward Kay, who's part of our coordinator team, to come up here. And Ward is going to walk us through the themes that emerged and also give us some of the kind of anonymous quotable quotes that came out of this as well. So as he comes up now, I'll have you go ahead and reach around the table. You'll find one of these theme sheets, and you can pull that out and follow along with them. So.
All right. You're going to have to excuse me. I'm not teaching this past year, and so I miss it. So dealing with Professor K here with my clicker, but I always have present. So we had the prayer groups, and for those of you who participated, most of the prayer groups we did with three people stayed together at their own. Set their own times, when they can best get together, and do that. We also, though, have some unique groups that also form together. For example, the parents of young children's Sunday school class and the youth class Sunday mornings did the same thing that people were doing triplets in the Sunday school hour. And so those groups went through the same process, used the same study guide, but in a larger group. We had I was sitting with Bill, who did it with the Russ and Bill Lights. We're together doing it over the phone together. Frederick's did it there. I mean, in Florida. We also had a drop-in group for those who were traveling a lot. That was the group that I had. We sometimes had eight people in that. Sometimes we had three. Sometimes the leader slept through it. but yeah, it was a really good group. And each week, you never knew exactly who was going to be there. But we also still bonded together, even though those few times we were together. Each time was a significant event. So this was a spiritual journey that we took during Lent. This church has long as you're doing Lent studies, so I love that we're doing this during Lent, and as part of our tradition of a Lenten study. And so we found it very affirming, and we were also challenged. And as we said, we go through on this spiritual journey. There's some themes that showed up. I mean, you have in front of you on your table 10 ideas that came up, and I'm going to kind of walk through those. I have the exact same verbiage as on your left side, so I'm not going to repeat that, but I will say it. So the first thing that came up was there's a need for clarity, purpose, and identity. We felt that this was a time for us to bring who we are a unique identity. And this is something that came out through it. There's also a lot of people love the small groups that we're meeting for and love this opportunity. And so that's something that came through. And one person said, we felt convicted that sometimes we had been neglectful of this kind of close communion and how important it is to nurture ourselves and others. We were reminded that experiences that open ourselves up to the Spirit's leading through open and honest sharing with others are vital. And I found this to be true. I loved, one of the things that I loved about this was listening to people's journeys, to understand how God is working in people's lives and how they came to be here. And it, you know, sometimes you just know people from sitting in a business meeting, you don't get the idea of the spiritualness that's behind it. That was, it was a wonderful experience. And small groups is something we should look for. Right. Intentionality, right? That in order for the church to be more intentional as a whole, I have to be more intentional. By taking that, we want the church to be intentional, I have to take it personal level. Right? Another quote here is, we don't have to be the greatest, just faithful. Missions. It's all about people asking, where can I make a difference? Family and friends sharing stories are what inspire us to engage in mission. Excitement about the future. The fire's coals are deep and alive. We are bringing the fuel. God is providing the air to reignite the fire. Communication. The bugaboo of this church for what I've been here. We have fertile soil at BBC, but we need to spread the fertilizer around and help more people participate. Sometimes people need to be asked to do a difficult thing. Thank you for correcting me. Sometimes we have to be asked. Right? Sometimes we get in our own rut to do it and we need to be asked to do a different thing. Sometimes, you know, if there's something difficult, I'm going to say, I'll add that the Spirit spoke there, not Freud. Leadership, development, and involvement. We are in transition and have a possibility to increase the involvement of members of the church and the church and the community and grow in our service to God and others or not, depending on choices we make and actions we take as individuals and as a church. Gratitude. We need to build a culture of gratitude where we celebrate God's faithfulness to us and the contributions of all members. And getting to know the local community. There is a role for BBC in the new and changing Vienna. We have much to offer the local community. God has work for us to do. Our potential will only be realized if BBC embraces a theology of risk, adventure, and courage, and becomes a people inspired by a vision of a better world and plans to do something about it. Work for us to do, so I'm going to ahead and close the floor.
One of the things, as I read through these things, and especially just again this morning, this afternoon, as we go through these quotes, the positivity, the energy, the optimism. I love this last quote here. I think it really captures many of the things that emerge here. This sense of adventure. Our church, that we've always said of ourselves as people of faith on the journey of life, but what is that destination, and what if we begin to look at the road ahead as a great adventure for us? And to hear that spirit come through over and over again in these reports, it got me excited and really looking forward to the remainder of this process. But as an old TV host would say, but just don't take my word for it. One of the things we thought, you know, these things are great and work to do a wonderful job, but we also want to take the time to share stories together and hear those stories. So I'm going to invite our smaller prayer coordinator, Trula, to come up here. And Trula is going to in turn invite some of the people who participated in this process to come up and share the stories, what engaged them, what inspired them, what encouraged them as they were here. So.
Which one do I need? This one? Okay. When Trudel called me and asked me to do a talk, I thought she was asking me to give a sermon. So I prepared a sermon. It's only 20 minutes long. So, let's go. No, this is not a sermon. Small groups are all about relationships. Relationships with each other and a relationship with God. I believe the kingdom of God is all about the relationship. End of sermon. Our group was made up of Rabbi Rance Riley, Nancy Curtis, and me. We had never been members of the same small group together before, yet we bonded almost immediately in the first meeting. By our second meeting, we had lowered our defenses and were willing to be vulnerable. As a result, we were aware that we were partnering with the Spirit in praying for BBC's renewal. Also, by our second meeting, we were in touch with how small groups have been at the center of almost everything BBC has done, making BBC who we are today. I don't have enough time to touch on everything we talked about and recall that is the result of small groups, but I'll give you a small sample. Our church color came up with a small group. Lost River Retreat Center, small group. Ordaining Women came from a small group. Our beautiful worship space. Our decontained structure. The alliance that we have with the organizations that we are connected with now. The Alliance of Baptist, North Star, Quality Baptist Fellowship, or the cooperative program. You see, all of these came out of a small group's effort to line us up with who we could best work with. Joining these was important. And our mission action groups were the impetus for small groups. You know, our daily bread, our connection with committed to help others, and all of the others came out of small groups. So Gladys, Nancy, and I concluded early on, if our church is going to experience renewal again and growth, it will come out of small groups. Maybe the Spirit is already making this happen through the prayer groups that we are celebrating today. Next.
I should have a sermon prepared as well. It's the third one today. But you're lucky, that's not entirely true. It's just a crumpled up piece of paper.
would love to thank everybody for giving me a brief moment here at the microphone to share some personal reflections about the small group experience. Our group was composed of Ann Cyrus, Pat Layton, and yours truly. When we were first asked to participate in the small groups, my honest first reaction was, oh, I don't have time. Nobody has time for anything. And I have little kids, and I'm traveling a lot for work. My schedule's so packed. How do I fit one more commitment in my week? And so I just felt too stressed, too thin. And so the more I prayed about it and thought about it, I realized that, kind of as Bill said, I mean, it's vitally important at this juncture of church's history to retreat to the small group setting and get into a more personal and open discussion setting and venue, and really start to explore where we've been, where we are, and where we're going as a congregation. When I found out that my group was going to be with Ann and Pat, I was going to make a joke about Ryan, but I was just kidding. So I was joking. Okay. All right. That's kind of just kidding. Okay. No, in all seriousness, I was very excited, actually. And we've known each other for a few years, but mainly from interacting on Sunday mornings only. And so, you know, it was a great opportunity to get to know each other at a deeper level and let our guard down and be open about how we really do feel about things and what we hope for the church in the future. So when we got to the first meeting, I knew that I was in the right group for me when that discussion began. We quickly, I think, began to let our guard down. And we began sharing some personal stories that related to the discussion at hand, and began to open up with each other about our hopes and dreams for the church. By the second meeting, it was, I really knew it was the right meeting for me, because there were snacks that began showing up. So they began appearing and then disappearing before the meeting was over. So I knew it was in the right spot. That was pretty awesome. So, in discussing the past, present, and future of the church, we talked a lot about the strong mission focus of the church, how we are a congregation as well, good soil. We do have roots that run deep, and certainly we are on rocky soil. But maybe as Bill alluded to a little bit ago, or I'm sorry, Ward alluded to, maybe need a little bit of fertilizer, maybe to re-energize ourselves and refocus the congregation. So, but we did definitely talk about how we felt the mission is a focus of the church and how it shaped our identity as a congregation. And surely it's impacted each of us at a deeper, more personal level, not only within our group, but throughout the congregation, no doubt. For me personally, it's been our daily bread. And just that was the first mission activity that I had taken part in the church. And so I think just even a simple act of distributing food to those in need in our community really opens my eyes to the level of need that exists in our backyard, that our church can have an immediate and lasting impact on. And so as we discuss the future direction of the congregation, focus somewhat on how personal satisfaction can be gained from participating in mission activities, as well as their impact on the church and the community, how that can in fact be contagious, and as folks become excited about participating in different opportunities, it doesn't have to be just mission, it can be things here at church, and maybe doing so in smaller groups even, as we discovered that became more our conversation, our discussions were more engaging in a smaller group than they might be in a larger setting. So maybe even in the future, some mission opportunities are maybe even focused on a smaller setting than maybe always it, you know, feel like it has to be a lot of people to do something, can be a smaller group and have that be just as meaningful as a larger group. I think only through the small group setting can we have cultivated conversations like this that were such so candid. By letting ourselves enter simply out of our comfort zones, we did start to open our hearts and minds to a true discussion about the future of the Baptist Church. So by allowing ourselves to open to seeing the needs around us in the church, then we can transform our individual and collective mindset from what am I receiving from UBC on Monday mornings, or excuse me, Sunday mornings, to what does God have in store for us as a congregation or for me? How do I use my time and talents to become an active giver rather than a passive receiver? Well, I suppose you can guess we didn't come up with all the answers, as maybe there's some groups that did, but we didn't.
I think that one of the most striking answers that we did come up with is that we as individuals and we have Baptists are not at a destination or trying to get to a specific destination per se, but rather we're on a journey together. And this collective experience, this journey, is ever-changing, and it's what we make it. We can choose to watch it happen, or we can help make it happen. We are, after all, a people of faith on the journey of life. As a group, I think that this may have been our aha moment, week 7. Then we quickly adjourned. We realized we were editing. And we were out, and snacks were going too, so that was it. So, as a last thought, I just wanted to express my gratitude. This is a great experience. And in the end, I think I would have been missing out had I not done it. So, it was good. And I think I would encourage everyone in this room who you maybe did take part in a group, if the opportunity comes up again, to do so. It's definitely very fulfilling. So, thank you.
I usually speak off the cuff, but I was encouraged to make sure that it was the right thing. So I just want to say that I've been part of the congregation since 2004, and I'm just going to get right to it. The Lenten prayer experience this year was truly the most intimate, honest, and Christ-affirming experience that I've ever had during this time. And I've been in a lot of wonderful experiences. It was intimate because there was an implicit and immediate level of trust. My partners were Hazel and Ermgar. And Ermgar always had tea. And honest because our responses were what they were right that minute. We didn't measure them. We didn't worry about what the other person said. We accepted each other's uncertainty at times. We shared our responses to the scripture and the questions from dramatically different backgrounds. If we didn't know, we just sat with that, not trying to fill the silence. I had the sense of the entire time being with prayer and of the specific instructions to pray being redundant. And they were Christ-affirming. There have surely been many experiences of Christ in my various church activities, but this was the right time. Ermgard and Hazel were the essential people who allowed me to be open to the presence of the living Christ in each of us and in that space. I was aware of the fact that we were in the Lenten season of the church year, yet I don't even pretend to understand what happened when Jesus of Nazareth was crucified on a Roman cross and appeared to his disciples 3 days later. I have considered and rejected a number of explanations. I am reconciled to the mystery of that. I remember Hank Dunn expressing the truth that I believe he learned from a 13th century theologian and mystic Meister Eckhart, that we have all of God that we are ever going to have. I was aware during the prayer times that I was fully present to that understanding. Even though I can't explain it to you very well, I was sure that Christ was present with us, in that space, in each of us. It has been some time since I had experienced truly being the body of Christ as I did in those times. Christ spoke truth to power. He healed the sick and cared for the poor. He loved God and people and taught others to do the same. That's still what Christ does.
For us, we chose that early little day, Sunday afternoon, Saturday morning. We set a meet in the morning before the day got started. And at first, I was kind of really waiting and think it worked. But it worked out really well. For me personally, reflecting that early in the day, I was kind of away from alert and I didn't have any of the cloud of kind of worries and what you've got to do for me. And so I could focus a lot more. And I thought that might have been true for Lee and for Kara. way the way it was organized, the seven sessions, the intentional kind of progression through the topics worked really well. And also having a small group, because everyone else has said before, when it's a group of 10 or 20, you know, I can't make this one, I'll catch up on the next one. When it's three, you really have to commit to each other, and I thought that really had a lot of value and experience for all of us. And it sounds like a good group as well. We can keep try to focus on the questions at hand, and we can get to know each other better as well. So I think a lot of what we decided we were motivated to do, which I'll cover at the end, kind of left it all out. So I kind of looked through our notes and thought about our conversations and said, how about summarize what the ground we covered? And they kind of broke down into questions and statements. And so the questions that I saw in our conversation were intention, focus, my purpose, inspiration, motivation, and how. When we got into the how things could be different, kind of the statements became statements along the lines of respond, engage, love God, love my neighbor, actions of service, and new directions. As we work our way through this, we had a lot of conversations like you guys did as well about what can we do differently? What can we do to make this, to catalyze kind of where we go from here? And it tended to fall into kind of four or five themes. One was participate in more small group gatherings, fellowship, missions, learning, families. Along with everybody else, felt that, getting together in a small group really gave us a chance to get to know each other much better than we ever do. Just talking a little bit in the foyer on committee. Also, get to know each other better. We're all pilgrims on this journey. We like some of the activities we have now as well as some of we've had in the past where we get together midweek, 7 days, a long time between Sundays. And so, midweek activities, meals, small group focuses, mission group meetings is a nice way to kind of keep us connected between Sundays. So it's, and there's a lot that we do that sometimes we don't feel we communicate as well and celebrate. So communicate and celebrate the accomplishments of our congregation, our youth, where they're going, things that we've done. And our involvement with the community is so much that we do to bring life to ourselves and to share it with others that we just want to celebrate and communicate more effectively. And then there are lots of opportunities to help, and everybody is involved in many of those. So we just want to do a better job communicating and responding to those opportunities to serve, be involved both within BBC and beyond BBC. So it became clear, and this is probably obvious statement, but BBC is entirely us to combine inspiration, motivation, and love of all of us. Thanks.
Churches are motivated primarily by a love for God and others, while the self and survival focused churches are primarily motivated by fear, the fear of failing, fear of shrinking, and fear of not having enough. The second week was on gratitude and emphasized the importance of taking time to celebrate and thank primarily God, but also one another for past successes and current steps forward. The third week focused on confession, not meaning assigning guilt or blame, but emphasizing communication, being honest with ourselves and others, and treating each other lovingly. The fourth week focused on faith versus fear. What I got out of this was that for me personally, and also for us as a church, we can't wait until circumstances are perfect to take action. We must act and trust that if God calls us to do something, He will give us what we need to succeed. The fifth week was on expectations. Discussing this, we talk about helpful expectations, but the difference between asking or expecting people to just fill in every slot versus expecting and also helping members to serve in ways that use and grow their God-given gifts and passion. We also talk about the importance of personally inviting and actively encouraging all members to be engaged and involved. If we stop asking members who have not volunteered before, everyone, the church, the mission, and especially that person, loses out. Members also need to be willing to carefully and prayerfully consider each invitation, and if the answer is no, work to find the area of service they do feel called to. The sixth week was about holy urgency, or how to keep a passion for ministry and service strong. We discussed having top-binding missions to engage members' passions and use their God-given gifts would help maintain energy and enthusiasm. We also felt personal connections are extremely important. It's much harder to give up on individual people than a nameless, faceless group. Also, we discussed the importance of recognizing an urgent need and serving now with what we have and trusting in God instead of waiting for some future time when circumstances might be better to act. The final week, God has something for us to do, was about God's plan for us. What I got from this whole experience is a strong feeling that God does indeed have something for us to do. My vision for the Anabaptist Church would be to be a church that helps every willing member identify and grow their God-given gifts and passions, and enables members with similar passions and complementary gifts to find one another and join together, whether it's a small group or a large team, to use these gifts to serve God and others. And in doing so, we would increase the involvement of each individual in the church and of the church in the community and the world.
Okay. going to tell you a story that really happened, but I think it ties right into this group when you're looking for the way the Lord can lead us. For the younger folks here, I'm an old soldier, and the guy's been put up with me for about 45 years here. In the Second War, they ended the war before I finished my training, so I suddenly found I had an appointment to West Point, and I entered the college up there. We lived in small rooms, and three of us shared most of our time up there together. Now, I'm a little Missouri guy, kind of half farmer and half country. One of our roommates came from Chicago. He was a typical Chicago street guy. And one was a farmer from Nebraska. And so for 4 years, we worked and studied together. And in those days, we went to church, marching in properly. And in 1950, we graduated. Three brand new second lieutenants thrown out on the world. And 3 weeks later, they started the war. The Korean War started. Well, I had gone into cavalry, so I got real pretty fast. One of the guys went infantry, but he was already in Europe. He didn't get to Korea. He got to some other actions later. And one of the guys went into the Air Force. And 6 months later, he was dropping bombs in Korea. Okay. This went on for the normal officer period, 30 years. And all three of us completed our 30 years. All three of us came out as colonels. Now, what does that have to do with what we're doing here? Well, the first one got out, my infantryman, and he settled just south of Alexandria. And in a year, he was rebuilding the Unitarian Church just south of Alexandria. 5 years later, this gang came to me and said, hey, why don't you chair up the committee that's going to rebuild our church? And a whole bunch of us had a wonderful time building what we have now as our church. Well, I didn't know what the other guy was doing. My infantryman, I didn't see for 20 years. We ended up in the War College together. But the guy that went Air Force, never did see him until after graduation. But last summer, we had a reunion at West Point. We all got together. And what do you think he had been doing in Grand Forks, North Dakota, or Nebraska? He was rebuilding a church. Now you tell me how three Midwestern farm boys can serve their country for 30 years and come back and build churches. I think it's pretty cool.
The experience that you'll have, and thank you for sharing, as you come through, the spirit that comes out, all of us are in the task of rebuilding, all growing and building together. And while these prayer experiences, we have only a small snapshot in time, what amazing opportunity would it be for us to gather together in this room 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, to look back on this moment at the time threes gathered together to pray about this church, to pray about the future of this church, and then to come back together and to tell the stories of what they did and how God called them to serve. What an amazing testimony. And I think Jenny is coming on her way. As Ward mentioned, we had some groups that were more than triplets and do this, and
Jenny will come. I think she has been designated not only speaking for herself, but on behalf of the group that she represents. So,
As you heard, the youth did the study together, and I cleared my words with them, so this is their files. It's not just me making up facts for them. But just wanted to bring word to you that you have a group of young leaders who look up to you and look up to this church and what you have done and realize the models that you are. But also, sorry to chomp at the bit of, okay, soon it's going to be my turn. If not soon, it's now. And so I loved having our discussion together. As I tell the youth, we learn from each other. I learn as much from them, maybe even more than they learn in our discussion. I love the ideas that you brought up of thinking about the future, wanting more hands-on mission projects, ways that they can get involved in the community, but also just opportunities for leading in worship or leading in general. I think growing up, at least my experience as a youth, it was kind of like, oh, the youth minister talks to the youth. At a church this size, and it's a wonderful size, you have the opportunity to work and mentor and have conversations with the youth around you. It's not just me. As you, we know the saying, it takes a village to raise a child. And so just know that the youth have look up to you as models, and they are creating their own thoughts and ways of doing things. And be open to that. Maybe it's not the Wednesday night that you grew up with, but finding ways to fellowship that work with their schedules and their needs and what they want to do. But again, just on behalf of them, it was great thoughts that they had and a great group of leaders that will take on leadership as well. And so pray for us as we continue to look at what may our gifts be and how we can use those for the church, and as well as just get to know us. So thank you.
Well, I would stay here all afternoon and hear stories. And I hope there is no way for us in this short program to capture all of the ways that God spoke to you and you felt the Spirit moving in your life. But in the weeks to come, I encourage you, talk to some folks that you see gathered here. Talk to other folks in other prayer groups that you aren't a part of. And share stories with one another. And in this way, we begin to build up one another, to encourage one another, and to continue to build upon the Spirit that's moving in our midst from our youth all the way up, all the way through. So it seems incumbent upon me. I don't know about you, but I'm ready to go do some things now. But we've got work to do, right? As the famous question would go, where do we go from here? What's next? What happens after this moment today? There's a couple of things. The first, as works out, I will give another shameless plug. This weekend, we will be out at Lost River. If you have not signed up, please come out. You don't want to miss this. Even if you can come out on the Saturday, part of Saturday, you don't want to miss out. We'll be learning so much about ourselves as a community, but also our local community, our neighborhood. What's that look like? And how do we experience what it means to be church in Vienna today? And if that's not enough for you, there's this gorgeous chapel that's out there that I know you'll want to worship at as well. But some wonderful conversations. If you can't make it out there this weekend for whatever reason, we will try and make some of those materials available so you can be part of the conversation. Because what our banquet today is about and what our prayer experience has been is about beginning this new adventure. And that's what we're going to be on for the next few weeks together. So we're providing more opportunities in the weeks ahead to have more conversations like this, to learn more and to listen to one another. And that begins with our retreat. And then after that, and as we're coming up, if we're going to get to know our local community, it would seem odd for us to do that just in an isolated room somewhere behind locked doors. We want to get to know our community so we can serve them better. We have to go out into the community to talk with our neighbors and to listen to them. So we'll be partnering with First Baptist Church Vienna and also one of the local mission groups, Voice, Virginia's Organized for Interfaith Community Development. Through May and until June, our church and other sister churches in the area will be doing 250 small group listening sessions in our community, from PTAs to teachers, Sunday school classes. And as we do this, we'll be learning about what our neighbors value, what do they need, and how do we best serve them. And so we had seven members from DBC come on April 10th to get trained in leading small groups. If you're interested in helping to lead these small groups, working with some of the leaders from First Baptist, you can let me know. I can keep you updated as we go forward. Even if you just want to sit down and take notes in listening sessions, that is a gift in and of itself. So we'll spend the next few weeks listening to our neighbors. And you can also go ahead and you can mark on your calendars on May 22nd after church. We'll gather together in this room for another banquet. This time it'll be our celebrating mission banquet. We're going to look at the life of the Anabaptist. I think you have heard over and over again today the importance of mission in the life of this church and how we have found renewed energy in each chapter by reaching out and meeting the needs of our local community. So we're going to talk about that. And not as a way of just looking back at the past, but what does our story of faith as a congregation, what does our history and missions tell us about our calling today, and how does it motivate us as we move forward? So we'll be talking about that. Well, I might even find a way to have some guest speakers in as we come and speak about mission. And I'm spending last week and next week working with Marshall Road Elementary and their principals and leaders there. So we'll be building upon these things. Some things to look forward to. So I'll close with this. At the beginning of last year, I came to the church council and the diaconate, and I handed them these cards. And I said, on this card is what we're going to try and accomplish together in this next year. This is what we're going to do. Coming out of my conversations with the congregation, here's what we have. So the front of this has our vision, our mission, our purpose, and our values. Our first theme that came out of our prayer groups today, we want to create a shared sense of purpose for our church and bring clarity to our unique identity as a community of faith. As we go on, we see words about our mission, living out our values. Well, on the back of that card was this verse from Habakkuk, at a time in the life of Israel that I find very apt for us. Habakkuk writes, this is God speaking to the people, write the vision, make it plain on tablets so that a wandering reader. But there's still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end, and it does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not be there. Our task this summer is to gather together to pray, to listen, to discern the unique vision for the future that God has for us. And as these weeks go on, as we gather together for retreats, as we meet with our neighbors, as we come together for banquets, if that vision seems to tarry, seems to be taking just too much time, wait for it. It won't delay. It will come at the appointed time. It will fill us with a sense of adventure, with a theology of risk, with a knowledge that God has work for us to do. It's called us to make a difference in our community. And so, the adventure begins. So pack your bags, grab a compass and a map. We might throw out the map midway through, but that's okay. Because we're going somewhere, and God journeys with us. I'm excited as we go ahead. I'll get some cards up here if you want to take one.
For those of you who enjoyed this prayer group experience and you want to continue on, I am happy to help your group find some resources to continue to meet and talk. If your Sunday school class wants to learn how you can get involved in local missions, I would love to help you. We have ministers here and lay leaders who would love to do so as well. This is not the end of a conversation. It's not the end of a process. It's the beginning. And so let's go on this adventure together. Will you join me as we pray and close our Bible? God, today we give thanks for who you are to us and for us, for the ways in which you have called us together, that you have been on this journey of faith with Vienna Baptist Church since 1955, when we started as a mission. You've grown with us. You have walked with us. And God, we enter a time in which we turn to you anew to see what new things are you creating in our midst. What new mission are you calling us to fulfill? What new vision are you writing on our hearts? So today, God, we pray that you would fill us with a sense of adventure, that you would work for us to do. Fill our hearts with courage. Inspire us, God, to the journey ahead. And may we never cease from gathering together in small groups. May we never stop encouraging one another and supporting each other on the journey of life. May we walk this adventure with positive optimism, with great heart, with all our strength, that we might love you and serve others, our hearts, our minds, and our souls. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.